So big congrats to Mohammed for securing a job at the Refugee Center. We are the only refugee-led organization that operates throughout Canada. We are not only Calgary-based, we have branches in Toronto, in Vancouver, in Montreal, as well as Calgary. I want to introduce a very special person. This person is probably the most hardworking MLA in Calgary, and this person has been one of my good friends, a mentor, a friend to the community, and anything you want to help, whether the government, to understand how it works better, how government can help you, this person is also there. This person is very special because he came to Canada as a government-sponsored refugee himself. So I want to introduce with that our friend, our MLA, Irfan Sabri. Irfan.
Thank you so much, Asylum, for that introduction. I'll be using this table as a podium to have some formal remarks. Again, thank you to the Jumpstart Refugee Talent for organizing this important conversation about economic inclusion of refugees and bringing us all together to be a part of this important discussion. Let me begin by recognizing that we are gathered on the traditional lands of Treaty 7 First Nations, and also recognizing and acknowledge Métis people of Alberta who share a deep connection with this land. Economic inclusion of refugees and newcomers is a challenge facing us all as a society. And I want to say that I firmly believe that those who are on the receiving end of this issue, those who are facing this challenge of setting up a new life here, they are the ones who are best positioned to identify issues facing them, define the issues facing them, and explain to the rest of us that what it looks like to be a newcomer, to be a refugee in this country. And they are also the ones who are best positioned to tell us all how to address these issues and what they need to be successful in this country. Their voices, their perspective, their views must be front and center of decision making and any policy or decision that impacts them must be informed by their voice. So I'm mostly here to listen and learn about these issues and potential solutions that you all may have in common.
There's a part of my mind that wants, a part of my mind believes that it's my job in 4 months to help somebody find a job, and that seems really daunting and almost too hard to try. And what I found instead is that much better attitude for me is to just show up and see what I learn and see what I might know of that might be helpful. And that's where I found a more effective focus for me.
Great. Well, thanks. Asylum. So tell us a little bit about yourself, Asylum.
Okay, I'll try to keep short. I came to Calgary 23 years ago. I run a business with my family, so I'm an immigrant family. And the business we run is in a generational business, so it's my dad, my wife, and myself. And we have one major business, which is our printing, commercial products, things like that. And then I have another business, which is wood repair. So we employ about anywhere from 13 to 20 people, depending on when the time of the year. I've been asking this question some time ago, and we've always had about 60-70% immigrants or refugees working at us. It wasn't by design, it's just so that's what we do.
Okay. So, Pastor, I'm going to get you the microphone a little closer so they can hear you clearly. So, as an employer, so thank you for hiring refugees into your business. Can you maybe share with us
us, and I believe for the employees as well. For us, we are just like any other employer, we're looking for a great attitude and a drive. And we found that new immigrants and refugees have that. We can train for everything else. We can train you to be a graphic designer or a technician or a repair person. But we can really can't train attitude or drive. And once we see that, it's exciting to see somebody grow and build a company. So for both of us, I guess it works really well.
So same question I'm asking Mark, for any employers in the audience, what might you say to them, given your experience of hiring refugees?
Well, a lot of times we take it for granted, the resume, for example. And the type of resume you're always looking at, not relevant experience. But you'd be surprised as the things that are not on the resume, that are out there that you don't know about these employees. And those are the valuable things. Those are. I can share a really quick story about. Right now, I have a refugee that I hired from Afghanistan. He came to the store and said, "I want to clean," and he was angry. So I took him aside and I asked him, "What's your story?" The story was he'd been running a print shop in Afghanistan for 10 years. So he wanted to come to my shop to clean because he just wanted the opportunity. He didn't speak any English. He's been one of the best employees we've had in the past 10 years. And he's teaching us. So right off the bat, you go, "Nah, maybe not. What are we going to do?" But that's an example of a great thing that's happening.
Fantastic. Thank you for sharing. Bob, can you tell us a little bit about yourself?
I'm a software developer from Ukraine. I have been in Calgary for months. I'm from Ukraine.
Okay, and you said 4 months. So you haven't experienced the Calgarian winter yet?
Yes, I came to Canada from Indonesia directly. And it was a very interesting experience, from plus 70 to minus 75.
I think that deserves a round of applause. That's a transition in and of itself. Buckland, can you maybe share with us in the 4 months you've been here, how did you hear about Jumpstart Refugee Talent?
It's a very interesting story. I came to Canada, I don't know anything, just looking my phone to minus 35, and my friend gave us key from some house. I was very shocked because I never seen person, and I never meet with the person who was owner, and the owner of this house with Simon. It was our first miracle. In Canada. Simon was at Corky and just give us key and say, "Please leave and set out." Every time when I think about this, I can feel that very pleasure from this experience, and this house very dear to me, and Simon very dear to me, and every time when I'm thinking about this, I feel so very great. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bob. Lila, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Something that takes me an hour to listen to me. But briefly, I arrived to Canada 3 years ago, and literally, I have no idea about Canada, or even how to use the GPS to find my way. I locked up in a room in the basement and was looking for, I actually was into basement, he was a friend of my friend, and he helped a lot with his friends, they supported me a lot. And then I was looking for a female to help me, to listen to me, to help me find a
She helped me find a place. She was always there for me whenever I had a question, whenever I had any support. And then she told me about Jumpstart Refugee, where I started. She asked me about my background. I used to be an English teacher back home. I taught secondary school for almost 18 years. And when I tried to enter this professional field, I've been told, like, you have to have the Canadian experience, or you have to apply with your certificate. So I said, okay, that's fine. And by the way, I studied 3 years in Iraq for education. And when we moved to Gaza, they didn't recognize my certificate, so I had to restart it from the first year. I was in the first year with people who are seniors, while I had to be juniors and graduate. And it was very hard to me. I cried many times for my dad, saying, I don't want to continue. I'm correcting my professors. And he said, please, go on, hang on. Because you just need your certificate. It's gonna be your weapon through your struggle in life. That's all you need to have. And when I came here and when I got directed to IQAS to apply my certificate, it has been like equalized as English Department of Art. Come guys, I'm a teacher, 18 years of teaching back home. And it is the worldwide theories and the same like methodologies around the world. How come I have to go back again and have 2 years of studying again in one of the colleges to have certificate of education? So I felt disappointed to some point, and then I say there is a reason for being in Canada. I made my way to Canada by myself, no family, no friends, no supported group. I had a scholarship to United States, and my team is in 2019. And in the middle of the pandemic, they decided that, you know, that I moved to Canada. And then before moving to Canada, actually, I felt like, would you like to go back and live in Gaza? I'm from Gaza, and I don't know if all of you know about the situation in Gaza. It is a very harsh life. It is a conflict zone, actually, there. Where there are lack of electricity services. Even when I got the job, it was a governmental job. I didn't receive a whole salary during my 18 years of a professional field. Just like third of the salary or so on. So I decided to come here. Story short, and then Jumpstart Refugee helped me by having the Canadian resume. They went through it with me line by line, helped me to highlight my skills, skip the part that is not necessary, and I got my first survival job through Jumpstart Refugee, which was recent short one. Signed my first in there and accepted. And then one day after 9 months, I received a call from a society called the Tourist Society. It's in group care homes for a position of youth development worker, where I am there now and proud of myself. So thank you, Sina. First of all, thanks, Jumpstart Refugee, for helping me to settle up. And a big thank to my mentor, Tavana, who stayed side by side with me. She was really a rich resource for me and helped a lot in many fields, actually, not only the professional field, but also the humanitarian field.